Hello everyone, good evening, welcome to GS Course. This is Ajay Shyam. So I hope you all are fine, doing well, preparing well for the UPSC Prelims examination. So again, today we are going to discuss MCQs from economics. So this is the first question for you. And the first question is about asset monetization program in order to increase its resources. The first is asset monetization program of the government are carried out by Union Ministry of Commerce and Industry. This statement is wrong because the program is being carried by Department of Investment and Public Asset Management, DIPM, under Ministry of Finance. The second says, setting up infrastructure trust is a part of asset monetization. This statement is correct. The third says, capital restructuring of central public sector enterprise is an example of asset monetization. This statement is also correct. 2 and 3 are the correct answer here, correct statement. So C will be the correct answer. Now, what is the objective of asset monetization program? So the objective is to unlock the value of investment made in the public assets, which have not yielded appropriate or potential returns so far. Now, guidelines for asset monetization program include principle and mechanism for capital restructuring of PSUs regarding payment of dividends, issue of bonus shares, and buyback of shares by the PSUs. Now, asset monetization is a way of getting more cash on the balance sheet and reducing the debt to capital ratio that are crucial to rating agencies. That's all. So question number 2 is about recent amendment in Bank Regulation Act 1949. The first statement says the amendments will apply to urban cooperative banks and draw not rural cooperative banks. This statement appears to be true, but this is not true. But this statement is true, because the amendment will apply to urban cooperative banks and not to rural cooperative banks. Now, the second statement says Section 35 of the Banking Regulation Act deals with cooperative banks. This statement is wrong, because it's not Section 35A, but it is Section 56 which will deal with Banking Regulation Act of cooperative banks. The third says rural cooperatives are more in number as compared to the urban cooperative. This statement is also correct. So in this question, 1 and 3 are the correct. So option number B will be the correct answer here. Now, why this was is news? Because Union Cabinet recently changed the Banking Regulation Act to give RBI wider powers. Now, the amendment will apply to all urban cooperative banks and multi-state cooperative banks. And this will not be applicable to rural cooperative banks. If you talk about the current regulation, then cooperative banks are currently under dual regulation. First by Registrar of Cooperative Societies and then by RBI. The role of Registrar of Cooperative Societies include incorporation, registration, management, audit, separation of boards and liquidation. If you talk about RBI, then RBI is responsible for regulatory functions such as maintenance of cash reserve, capital adequacy and other some regulation. That's all. We'll move to the next question. Now, I will also tell you about this Section 35A. So Section 35A of Banking Regulation Act 1945 vests power in the RBI to give direction to bank and can take action. What type of action? To prevent the affairs of any banking company being conducted in a manner detrimental to the interest of the depositors or in a manner prejudicial to the interest of the banking company. That's all. Now, question number 3. So the question says the Global Talent Competitive Index, an annual benchmarking report, is published by Indian School of Business, INSEAD, World Economic Forum, World Bank. So the correct answer is INSEAD. Fine. So this Global Talent Competitive Index is an annual benchmarking report that measures the ability of countries to compete for talent. The report is published by INSEAD, the business school of the world, in partnership with Acado Group and Tata Communication. So fine. So I'll move to the next question here. Question number 4. So this says, with reference to long-term capital gains tax, consider the following statements. The first is long-term capital gains are often given more favorable treatment than short-term gains. This statement is correct. The second statement says LTCG tax is applicable to inherited properties which are held for more than 1 year. This statement is wrong, because capital gains are not applicable to an inherited property, as there is no sale but only a transfer of ownership. So only statement two is the correct answer here. So correct answer will be only first statement is correct. So correct answer will be option number A. Fine. Now some validation. So what is this long-term capital gain tax? So any profit or gain that arises from the sale of a capital asset is a capital gain. Now this gain or profit comes under the category of income. Hence the capital gain tax will be required to be paid for that amount in the year in which transfer of the capital assets take place. This is called capital gains tax, which can be either short term or long term. Now, long term capital gain tax is a levy on the profits from the sale of the assets held for more than a year, whereas short term capital gain tax applies to assets held for a year or less, and it's taxed as an ordinary income. Now, if you talk about the news related to this question, then budget 2020-2021 chose to retain long-term capital gain tax on equity mutual fund. That's why it was in news. This is question number 5. It's a very factual question. So Baba Kalyani committee was set up to draft a new model police act, recommend amendments in criminal law, a study of existing SEZ policy, or review of domestic production of production profile of oil and gas. So correct answer is option number C, study of existing SEZ's policy. So now some validation. So Baba Kalyani committee was constituted by Ministry of Commerce and Industry to study existing SEZ policy of India. Now the objective of the committee were to evaluate the SEZ policy and make it compatible with WTO and suggest measures for maximizing utilization of vacant land in SEZs, also suggest changes in SEZ policy based on international experience, and merge the SEZ policy with other government schemes like coastal economic zones, Delhi Mumbai industrial corridor, national industrial manufacturing zones, and also food and textile parks. Now if you talk about the key recommendation of this Baba Kalyani committee, then it recommended framework shift from growth export to broad-based employment and economic growth. It also recommended formation of separate rules and procedures for manufacturing and service SEZs, then shift from supply-driven to demand-driven approach, then promotion of integrated industrial urban development, that is walk-to-work zones, and enhance competitiveness. That's all. Question number 6, recently released India Human Development Survey suggests that consumption spending has grown between 2011-12 and 2017. Which of the following statements are correct? So first says the IHDS findings survey are contrary to NSS finding. This statement is correct, and this was in news in fact, this contrary report. The second says National Council for Applied Economic Research prepared IHDS report. This statement is also correct. The third says ISDS provides an assessment of changes in living standard. This statement is also correct. All 1, 2 and 3 are correct here. D is the correct answer. Now this question is a purely factual question. So we'll move to the next question. Question number 7. So question number 7 is about Krishnapuram onions that was in news recently. So the first says they are not used domestically due to their size and pungency. So this statement is correct. The second statement says they are export quality onions. This statement is also correct. The third says they are produced in the state of Karnataka. This statement is wrong because it's not Karnataka, but it is Andhra Pradesh. So 1 and 2 are the correct answer. So option number A is the correct answer here. So now some validation. So have you heard about this Krishnapuram onion? So let us see what is this. So Krishnapuram onions are a variety of export quality onions from Andhra Pradesh. Now the variety is not too popular in the domestic market and it is mainly grown for the exports. Now Krishnapuram onions are not used in kitchens due to their size and pungency. These onions are imported by Thailand, Hong Kong, Malaysia, Sri Lanka and Singapore. Now last year the government had banned export of onions when the prices of onions in the domestic shot up. Now they are also known as Krishnapuram rose onions. That's all. Question number 8. Recently government launched a new scheme called remission of duties and taxes on export product, RODTEP. Which of the following are correct? So RODTEP will replace merchandise exports from India scheme. This statement is correct. The second statement says RODTEP is inconsistent with WTO requirement. this statement is wrong because this is not inconsistent, but this is consistent with the requirement of WTO. The third says RODTP will have a fully automated route for input tech credit. This statement is also correct. So 1 and 3 all are here correct. So which answer will be correct? Option number B will be the correct answer here. Now some validation. So what is this remission of duties and taxes on exports product? So the objective is to offset infrastructure inefficiencies and associated cost involved in exporting goods which are manufactured in India, including products manufactured by MSME sector. That's all. Recently, RBI introduced long-term repo operation. Which of the following is correct regarding LTRO, long-term repo operation? The first statement says LTRO will be at the policy repo rate. This statement is correct. The second says LTRO will be conducted on CBS eCuvert platform. This statement is also correct. The third says LTRO can boost credit growth. This statement is also correct. All statement 1, 2 and 3 are correct. D is the correct answer here. Now let us talk about this long-term repo operation. So the central bank will conduct long-term repo operations of 1 and 3 year tenors for up to total amount of rupees 1 lakh crore at policy repo rate. Now LTROs conducted under this scheme will be in addition to the existing liquidating adjustment facility, that is LF, and marginal standing facility operations. Now what is the objective? The objective is that this is a direct incentives by RBI to boost credit growth, even as the Monetary Policy Committee earlier kept benchmark rates unchanged because of uncertainty in the inflation outlook. That's all. So the last question for you. So the last question is about CESS, fine. So the first statement says it is a tax on tax levied by the central government for a specific purpose. This is a very easy option. This statement is correct. The second says the tax revenue from CESS is credited to the public accounts fund. This statement is wrong because the tax revenue from CESS are first credited to the consolidated fund of India. And the central government may, after due appropriation made by the parliament, utilize the money for the specific purpose. The third statement says CESS comes under the divisible pool and hence they shall be shared with the states according to the recommendation of the Finance Commission. This statement is also wrong because the major feature of the CESS is that center need not share it with the state. So in this question, we have to choose the incorrect statement. 2 and 3 are incorrect. So correct answer will be option number A. Now some validation. So what is this CESS? So a CESS is imposed by central government in a tax on tax levied for a specific purpose. Generally, CESS is expected to be levied till the time the government gets enough money for that purpose. Now, CESS is different from the usual tax like excise duty and personal income tax, as it is imposed as an additional tax besides the existing tax, that is tax on tax. Now, another difference between CESS and the usual tax is the way in which tax revenue from CESS is kept. Revenue from main taxes like personal income tax is kept at Consolidated Fund of India. The government can use it for any purposes. But the tax revenue from CESS are first credited to the Consolidated Fund of India. And the central government may, after due appropriation made by the parliament, utilize the money for the specified purpose because of which the CESS has been collected. That's all for today. I hope you liked the class. Please like and subscribe our channel for more such videos. Thank you very much.